The Federal Reserve has kept its cool while things have been melting down. The coverage of the Fed repo madness has been largely suppressed to keep investors calm. We've seen this so many times before, though. Just take the many examples all throughout the financial crisis. Don't worry, there's ample liquidity. Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers are fine. Don't worry about AIG's exposure either. All good for subprime mortgages, too. Hey, no need to dwell on the past, right? I mean, everything is totally fine now, isn't it? You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. Today we're going to talk about what's happening with the Fed repos, give you an update on that. We're going to look at several economic indicators and show you what's really going on. I try to jam-pack as much information as I possibly can into these videos, so let's get into it right away. This is directly from the Fed's own website. You can see the repo and reverse repo operations. On Monday, October 7th, they hit $47 billion. This has been going on for a while. Initially, they said it was going to wind down, wouldn't be a problem, only temporary. It has continued. I have highlighted here on the channel in previous videos, just showing you what has happened, how they have extended this multiple times, now going into November. A lot of this has been whitewashed. It has been suppressed. They've talked about it like it's been really nothing. However, I disagree. And I know that you do too, because you are paying attention. This is also directly from the Fed's website, and you can see the dates and what they plan on doing. We never necessarily know what it's going to be until that particular day, but this gives you an idea of their plan. It's showing you that they are willing to pump in billions and billions of dollars every single day just to try to keep the market afloat. Now, the average person, they don't really know what's going on. They don't really care what's going on. All they care about is their 401k. They care about their pension. But if they would just spend 10 minutes a day learning about this stuff, I think their perspectives would change entirely. But most people would rather keep up with the Kardashians. Isn't that a sad story? Here you can see on a chart form, just showing you that over time, this has been an issue. While it isn't at the peak at which it was previously, clearly there is still a need for the Fed to intervene in the market. You've seen the balance sheet expand as well. I have highlighted that. On Wednesday, I'm going to do another video giving you the update on a week-by-week basis. We get that new data, and I will give that to you on Wednesday. There's always so much more going on related to what the Federal Reserve is up to, and we have to keep track of it all because the central banks are in fact controlling every aspect of the financial system. I wanted to touch on some points out of this Wall Street Journal article. Wild swings in repo rates raise concerns about bond markets' liquidity. As I have touched on initially, rates for overnight loans recently surged as high as 10% amid an unexpected cash crunch in the financial system. What happened last time during the financial crisis? Oh, we never assumed that this could ever happen. Oh no, the subprime issue really highlighted what was going on with the derivatives, and this was unexpected. All of this should be expected. The risks and the fragility are present today, not tomorrow, not next year. They are present today, and we need to realize that at any moment, all of this could come crashing down. Does that mean it's going to come crashing down? No, but if you aren't prepared for it, you could be wiped out. A lot of people have yet to recover from the financial crisis. Imagine that, a decade later, and here we are. Okay, so check this out here. If repo rates keep getting higher, the economics of making markets is going to be that much worse. Elevated repo rates could make bond dealers more selective about the securities that they are willing to buy from customers and hold on their books, making trading more difficult at times of market stress. So this is just one aspect that I wanted to mention here, why this is actually important. People are looking at it as in the Fed is going into the markets, intervening. We've seen that all before, but this is something else altogether. In the second paragraph, while the Fed has lent money overnight through the repo market at a typical interest rate of about 1.9%, traders have said that banks have frequently offered repo loans at rates around 2.5%. They are trying to stabilize this market, and they are trying to keep it within their range when you look at specifically the Fed funds rate, but that is proven to be very difficult. In a market in which you have complete control over it, and yet you still have trouble keeping it within this very unnatural range. The market wants higher interest rates, and although you would argue that point, suggesting that businesses and individuals, they want the lowest interest rates as possible. But in order to get them so artificially low, you have to print money. That's what open market operations are all about. This is something that I have talked about over and over and over and over again, something that I talk about in my book. And this, of course, shows you that time and time again, the more intervention, the worse it will eventually become. Bond investors tend to worry about liquidity or the ability to buy or sell a particular security because the market doesn't have a central exchange and a lack of trading partners could create wide gaps in prices at times of market stress. You don't have to worry about future events. You have to look at what's going on today. We have an unlimited number of concerns and cracks and fragile areas, and all of this spells disaster for people's 401ks, their pensions, and so on. If they're hurt, I assure you, the majority of people will as well. Because you have, for example, a financial company that starts to lay off a bunch of people. Now think about this. You look down the skyline of any major city, what do you see? Bank towers, financial companies. These are the ones that have all the money, they have a ton of employees, and their buildings house a bunch of other companies. If they start to turn down, you then have a ripple effect. It will affect everybody because those buildings, they have different businesses that surround them that rely on that particular financial institution to keep doing what it does. But now if they start letting people go, if they start letting some of that real estate go as well, you're going to have an impact. Just study what happened during the financial crisis. Not necessarily the reason why it occurred, not necessarily subprime crisis. We're not talking about dot-com boom and bust. I am talking about the simple effects, how it affects regular people on a day-to-day basis. Just take the example of HSBC. I brought it up on the previous video. If you haven't watched it, just go into my videos. You'll see the one about HSBC slashing 10,000 jobs. Wanted to show you this article out of the Telegraph. London will bear the brunt of 10,000 job cuts at HSBC as the firm battles to slash costs in the face of a slowdown gripping Europe. Analysts said that the axe could fall the heaviest in the UK, where the lender employs 40,000 people. Deutsche Bank cutting 18,000 people globally. Commerce Bank slashing 4,300 and 1,600 positions are being scrapped at the French lender Société Générale. This is why it is a concern. I keep seeing the comments constantly. People are saying, look at the total amount of people. They get these arbitrary numbers out of nowhere. Look at the total amount of population in the world. Look at the total bacteria on a person. Like, it's ridiculous, the numbers that they use, and they divide it by the numbers that I show on the screen. You have to understand the ripple effect. When you play chess, if you are simply playing move by move, you're gonna lose. You're always gonna lose because you can't look 3, 4, 5 steps down the road. I spoke about pension plans earlier in this video. General Electric said it would freeze pension plan benefits for about 20,000 US employees as it takes steps to slash its pension deficit and improve its financial position. How do you feel about that? If you're a GE employee, are you gonna be okay with this, especially when the next financial crisis hits and they start to slash? Forget about freezing, they're gonna slash. We're already in this condition right now where they are giving less and less and less, and we are going to see the slashing happening. I have talked about the cuts already from different pensions that in general seems to be about 30%. It depends on the company, of course, but we're going to see this. And I will reiterate what Jerry Brown, the former governor of California, said, that next financial crisis, they will have to slash the pensions. And this is coming from the governor himself. This is another article connected in with that. I found it funny because you can see the statement, GE to freeze pensions for about 20,000 employees. And guess what? The stock surges. The real people, the workers, maybe they're not going to get what they had hoped for. And instead, the stock surges. This is really similar to what we see in all of these cases around they fire a whole bunch of people and then the stock goes up. That, to me, is really terrible. GM furloughs more workers as union strike enters the fourth week. We see this over and over and over and over again. And I love the way that they use this term, furloughs. And it makes you think that, well, not so bad, don't worry about that. But this happens to be an issue that goes on all different sectors, but the point is the same. If a person wants to be working, in this case here, there's a strike. Maybe they have a health issue. Maybe there's something going on that is far beyond their control. Either way, if that person is struggling, they can't make the income that they need to, and that's going to affect them, their family, and of course, their general economy. Always understand the impact beyond what you see in the mainstream. Ex-Credit Suisse CEO calls negative interest rates crazy. Now, that is a term that I've used myself to describe this, but here we have the CEO in the financial world actually saying the same thing. Negative interest rates are crazy. That means money is not worth anything anymore. As long as we have negative interest rates, the financial industry will continue to shrink. This is so important. This really goes into what I was talking about earlier in the video. You have that ripple effect, you have the impact on so many people as a result, and this is not a good thing to see. Look at the EU bank stocks, okay? When you see this as an index, imagine it peaked out around 500. However, today sits at 83. Since the financial crisis, this has declined considerably. We have seen ups and downs along the way. Since that peak, though, it is down significantly. And look where it was. In the 80s, my goodness, in the 80s, it was at the same level. If you look at what has happened over the years, clearly we have an issue in the financial industry. Some people think, well, I don't care. I don't buy any of these funds. I don't buy any of these particular stocks. I don't have any reason to worry. But that isn't how it works. We need to be able to look into this a lot more clearly. And unfortunately, the majority just doesn't understand it. Charles Schwab says he would never buy the money-losing companies going public these days. And of course, we see this every turn looking at all of these particular stocks. That actually connects in with the next article here. Ex-NASDAQ CEO Greenfield warns that recent IPO's unclear path to profits reminds him of the tech bubble. Now, he makes it clear it's not the same as the tech bubble. It isn't as insane as the last time around. But he just mentioned something that I think is so important. We have these extreme valuations for these particular companies. We see all of this overzealous behavior, all of the euphoria, the excitement that goes in line with all of the information I've shown you here on the channel. And unfortunately, time and time again, people get screwed over. But I guess I'm different, you know, because the mainstream media says that the hard data says the US economy is just fine. Now, that's pretty interesting because I show some different information. When they look at all of this, it is really funny to see the mainstream media constantly projecting this, and it's quite sad. I get hate mail all the time, every single day from people who are completely and utterly unaware of what's actually going on. But they're employed, most likely, and they believe that what's going to happen over the next, let's say, year or 2 or 5 years, whatever it might be, is all in good hands, so we don't need to worry. Everything is just fine. Well, I'll leave that up to you. That's all for this video. If you found it informative, hit that thumbs up button. By hitting one button, you are supporting this channel, so I do appreciate that very much. If you want to build a business, to make money, to learn how to passively produce income, you got to check out my free, 100% free, step-by-step e-course on how to make money on Amazon. It's at theamazongps.com. If you're interested in the financial system, learning about it step by step, all the way through historically, understanding today, understanding back in the early 1900s, I have these two books which will explain everything to you. Check them out at the link in the description. If you like the audiobook more, check it out at themoneygps.com. Hang on a second, wait a second, don't go anywhere. This video is so important and so many people have watched it so far. If you haven't already, definitely click on it and then I will see you over there.